The new iPad sparks debate over 4G overseas. It's a bit of a problem. We got Drew Dowell to tell us all about it.
How's it going?
It's going awesome because you're here. Tell us about this.
well, the thing is, the new iPad's supposed to be, you know, 4G, LTE, whatever that is, promising super fast wireless service wherever. In Australia, though, it turns out it doesn't work on their networks. It also doesn't work on the networks in Sweden or in Germany, where they also have LTE networks, but they run on a different frequency. And so there have been some complaints, either by consumers or, in the case of Australia, by the consumer regulators.
Ouch. I mean, that's going to be ouch, ouch,
ouch. It shouldn't come as too much of a surprise, though. I mean, there is a technical
but
set of standards set
you would think
by the
that Apple
Union,
would know. You would think Apple
well,
would
yes,
know, wouldn't you?
That is true.
Honestly, I think it's very much in the tempest in a teapot sort of category. Apple did say which networks this will work on. They're in the U.S. and Canada. LTE is not built out very much beyond the U.S. Mm-hmm. You know, we wrote ourselves that it's almost a tablet for Verizon Wireless, really, because they have by far the biggest network in the world. Mm-hmm. But you know, you have a lot of media coverage about 4G, and I think it really does highlight that people don't really understand what this technology is very well, and that there are a lot of different flavors of it, and carriers are making competing claims, some of them, you know, legitimate, some of them less so. And you know, and Apple at this point is kind of caught up in the middle of it.
Mm-hmm. Hmm. And what are they doing? Are they offering refunds? Are they offering? I mean, what's happening?
Yeah, in Australia, they're going to offer refunds in the event consumers think they bought it in order to get 4G connectivity and aren't getting it. They're going to put up signs that say it doesn't work with the 4G networks. So don't buy it for that reason, and try and take steps to clarify it more.
Now, are consumers realizing this when they go to call their mobile provider and they say, okay, I'd like to sign up for this additional data service, and they find out actually we can't bring that to you?
Yeah, it's a good question. I don't know how it all came, how it all actually bubbled up in Australia. In Sweden, they say that the regulator says they've received a number of complaints from consumers. Germany says they haven't received any complaints. The reality is that not many people use the iPad on 3G networks either, right? It's primarily Wi-Fi use is how people go about using these things. So.
Well, the 3G was. I mean, I have a 3G iPad, and it's a bit spotty in what you can get through sometimes. And 4G, I mean, we had Walt on the set here,
right,
and it was moving like grease lightning.
Right,
I
but,
mean,
Walt, it was, Walt, but Walt also did a great explainer this week about what 4G really means.
I was going to mention
what it means
that
in the U.S.
Right.
The fact that some mobile carriers were making claims about 4G when it was actually just super fast 3G, HSPA
plus.
Right. In some cases, it's long-term evolution. In Sprint's case, it's WiMAX. So there are all these different terms being used to describe 4G right now.
Yeah.
Not entirely surprising there would be confusion, and that it may not be available in the same way in another country.
Yeah, and Walt's writing this 15 months after Verizon rolled out its LTE network, and whatever, 3 or 4 years after, or 3 years maybe after Clearwire started rolling out its network, more than a year after AT&T and T-Mobile started claiming that the networks that they had claimed initially were the fastest 3G networks are now 4G networks. So, the confusion has persisted, and a lot of that has been deliberately made to persist by the carriers themselves.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So it's not really surprising that consumers aren't quite sure what they're getting when it comes to 4G.
And I guess Apple's getting a bit of a black eye. You're saying it's a tempest in a teapot, but in some ways it's got to be seen with a bit of a black eye, saying, oh, yes, we're going to complain now, and you know what, we'll have to give refunds.
Well, I mean, we'll see. Look, I mean, they sold 3 million of these in the first 3 days, so obviously there's no shortage of demand for iPads. They've marketed mainly on the basis of their on the screen technology, not so much on the LTE, so we'll see if people feel that, they were misled by Apple, or if they just misunderstood. It doesn't seem to be a full-on backlash yet.
Mm-hmm.
You remember with the new iPhone 4 when there was antenna gate and all that sort of stuff?
Oh, you had to hold the phone like this. Remember that? You had to hold the phone like this to make a phone call? Yeah, I remember that.
And what? It wasn't wrong. I mean, we made the thing happen in our own sort of tests in the office, right? But the thing is, these became a bigger deal in the media than they became for Apple, than they were between Apple and its customers. And I have a feeling this is going to fall into the same category.
Mm-hmm.
Wise words from Drew Dowell of the Wall Street Journal. Thank you very much.
Thanks,
we really appreciate your time.